The barbaric murder of Jamal Khashoggi tells us something important about Saudi Arabia, but it also tells us something important about America. First, Saudi. As has often been noted, Khashoggi used to be part of the Saudi establishment. Although not a member of the House of Saud, he was well-born and well-connected. I met him first 14 years ago. He was one of the people who assisted me when I spent a week in Riyadh and Jeddah. Khashoggi was then working for Prince Turki Al Faisal, the longtime head of Saudi intelligence, who then became ambassador to Britain and would later become ambassador to the United States. Yet Khashoggi was, even in those days, a liberal and a reformer, though always moderate and incremental in his approach. He worried that too much reform would be disruptive. He said, "We do not want to break the society." Watching Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman's approach today, a mix of authoritarianism and real reforms, Khashoggi became more critical, but was never a radical. So why was he apparently seen as so threatening? Perhaps because he was respected within the Saudi establishment. Consider what Harvard's Tariq Masood told me just last week.
To see him run so afoul of that establishment, or run afoul of the monarchy, suggests that there is a deep cleavage within that establishment.
If so, this is significant. When the scholar Samuel Huntington studied the breakdown of authoritarian regimes in the 1970s and 80s, he noted that a schism within the ruling elite was almost always the precursor to a broader breakdown of the regime. Historically, Saudi Arabia has maintained stability because it was really a patronage state, not a police state. The kingdom has typically dealt with its critics and dissenters by buying them off, most importantly in the case of hardline clerics. Yet MBS, as the Crown Prince is known, appears to be changing the model from patronage to police state. He has mixed economic, social, and religious reforms with an ever tighter grip on power, shaking down businessmen, imprisoning activists, targeting news platforms, and now, it would seem, executing a columnist. Leaving aside their immorality, ruthless repressive actions such as these often tend to produce instability in the long run. Hosni Mubarak's crackdown during the Arab Spring did not save him. Bashar al-Assad's repression of dissent has come at a staggering cost, with his territory diminished and mostly in ruins. Ironically, for someone so ferociously anti-Iranian, MBS sometimes resembles no Middle Eastern ruler as much as the Shah of Iran, who was a reformer but also a despot, and was also much loved by Western elites. Mohammed bin Salman is a complicated figure. He has moved Saudi Arabia forward in some areas while moving it toward greater repression in others. But the larger issue for Washington is that America's foreign policy should not be based on personalities. Donald Trump's worldview seems utterly rooted in his likes and dislikes of other leaders, from Kim Jong-un to Angela Merkel to MBS. In the Middle East, this has led to the blind subcontracting of American foreign policy to Saudi Arabia. Washington has watched and de facto endorsed the kingdom as it ramped up its bloody war in Yemen, blockaded Qatar, quarreled with Turkey, and essentially kidnapped the Prime Minister of Lebanon. All these moves have, in large measure, failed. America's Middle East policy should be based on its interests and values in the region and beyond, and these will never be perfectly aligned with any one country. Historically, this has meant being an honest broker, respected by all major powers in the region. This requires nuance, sophistication, and ceaseless, high-quality diplomacy. But that is the price of being the leader of the free world, a job we appear of late to have simply vacated.